welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, China and Japan reached an agreement over the release of wastewater from Japan's destroyed Fukushima nuclear plant. Brian Lin has that story. John Russell and I present today's health and lifestyle report. We close by hearing the lesson of the day. But first,
China and Japan have reached an agreement over the release of wastewater from Japan's destroyed Fukushima nuclear power center. The deal prepares the way for China to restart Japanese seafood shipments it banned because of concerns over the wastewater. Representatives from both countries announced on September 20th a deal had been reached. Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida said the agreement had established a level of mutual understanding on the issue. China's government began banning sales of seafood coming from Japan more than a year ago. Officials said they were concerned the wastewater, which was treated to remove radioactive material, might poison seafood products sold in China. Japan has repeatedly said its testing and monitoring efforts have shown the treated wastewater presents no risk of radioactive poisoning to humans. Operators of the Fukushima Center announced in June 2023 that they had begun testing the process of releasing treated wastewater into the sea. The water first passes through equipment designed to remove harmful materials. Japan's government says the processed water is considered treated, not radioactive. But experts say it is impossible to remove all radioactive material from the wastewater. Government officials have said tritium, a radioactive form of hydrogen, is the only substance that cannot be removed from the water. However, they say the material is not considered harmful in small amounts. The water release program began in August 2023. Officials said it was a necessary part of cleanup efforts at the Fukushima Center. Three reactors there suffered meltdowns after a 2011 earthquake and huge ocean waves destroyed the plant's cooling systems. The disaster forced 160,000 people to flee surrounding areas that were affected by radioactive material. The agreement itself does not immediately remove China's ban on Japanese seafood imports. Kishida told reporters Chinese negotiators said the deal begins the process for China to revisit its import restrictions on the seafood products. The agreement calls for Japan to establish a long-term program in which international experts will carry out independent testing and monitoring. Kishida told reporters the government agreed to additional monitoring methods on the treated wastewater. A Chinese foreign ministry official said his country still has concerns about the safety of Japanese seafood products. Chinese and Japanese experts are expected to come together in the coming months to work on China's safety concerns. The official noted the ban will likely be lifted on products over time. Before the ban, China was Japan's biggest market for seafood exports. In the first half of 2024, Japanese exports of agriculture, forest, and fish products fell for the first time since 2020. The decrease is blamed partly on China's seafood ban. The International Atomic Energy Agency, IAEA, has worked with Japan on its monitoring efforts involving the released wastewater. The head of the organization, Director General Rafael Grossi, welcomed the latest agreement between China and Japan. Grossi praised Japan's government for its continued engagement with the IAEA. He also thanked the Chinese side for taking part in constructive negotiations with IAEA officials leading up to the completion of the deal. I'm Brian Lin.
Over the past 20 years, injuries related to dog walking have been on the rise among adults and children in the U.S., Johns Hopkins University researchers say. The most common kinds of injuries include broken bones, sprains, and head trauma. From 2001 to 2020, the estimated number of adults treated for dog walking injuries at emergency departments increased from 7,300 to 32,300 a year. That comes from lead researcher Ridge Maxson, who spoke to the Associated Press. Of those patients, 75% were women. 47% were adults between ages 40 and 64. But that information is only for visits to emergency rooms. Maxson said many people might seek treatment at other healthcare centers for their injuries, including at primary care, specialty, or urgent care clinics. He noted that dog ownership has become increasingly common in the United States, with about half of households having at least one dog.
Safe dog walking involves careful attention and, in some cases, special equipment. That can be especially true in bad weather conditions. However, multitasking, doing several tasks at once, can be dangerous. That includes using your mobile phone while doing something else. You can't really afford to relax when you walk a powerfully built dog. You have to pay attention, said Noel Holston, a dog owner in Athens, Georgia. In the early 2000s, Holston was walking his 30-kilogram dog in a park near his home when a large bird made a noise. His dog did what dogs often do and ran after the bird. That pulled Holston off the sidewalk. I stepped into a hole and heard my left ankle snap. The pain was so intense, I almost passed out, said Holston, who is now 76 years old. Running with a leashed dog is another risk, no matter how well trained you think your dog is. The activity is especially dangerous with a dog that is easily surprised or very young. That is what happened to Robert Godowski in New York City. My dog was relatively new to us. He got spooked and it got in front of me, and I went flying right over the dog. I ended up breaking two ribs, he said. There are other dangers in rural areas, said Stephen Haywood, an emergency room doctor in Corinth, Mississippi. Getting struck by vehicles, he said, that's definitely the most life-threatening injury when people are walking their dogs. Areas like his have many roads without sidewalks or wide shoulders. That is especially dangerous when people wear dark clothes with no reflectors or lights, and their animal also does not have such protection. In addition to lights and reflectors, there are other things that can minimize dog walking risks. During snowy or icy weather, wear shoes with good treads. Consider wearing shoes with spikes or studs. Maxson suggests using a non-retractable leash of 1.8 to 2.4 meters. Longer leashes are more likely to get tangled around your legs and cause falls. Retractable leashes can sometimes make your dog more difficult to control. They can cause burns when held too close to the body if they lengthen or retract too quickly. In San Francisco, dog trainer Shoshi Parks recommends a no-pull harness with a leash clipped to a dog's chest rather than their back. It gives the walker more control and puts less strain on the dog. Parks suggests holding a leash at your center of gravity, near your torso, hip, or thigh. Put your hand through the loop of a leash and hold it a little lower down. She calls retractable leashes no-go, meaning you should not use them. They can cause burns when held too closely to the body if they lengthen or retract too quickly.
For people with problems balancing or moving around, experts suggest seeking help walking a dog, especially in bad weather. Helpers could include a neighbor, an older child, or a professional dog walker. Haywood and Maxson agreed that balance and strength training exercises, especially for older adults, can help decrease the risk of falls and broken bones. And they said working with a dog trainer helps not only the dog, but the walker, who can learn to read their dog's body language better. Even young, healthy, strong people may have difficulty controlling larger breeds that aren't used to walking on a leash. Any exercise to give strength, give balance, is going to help, Haywood said. Make sure you can control the dog that you're walking. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm John Russell.
Now, John Russell joins me to talk a little more about that health and lifestyle report. Welcome, John.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me on the show.
So, the word retractable appeared many times in our report. Can you explain that term a little more for our listeners?
Sure. We can connect retractable to the verb retract. Retract has a couple meanings, but for the purposes of our lesson, let's focus on one meaning, to draw back or in. When we add the ending A-B-L-E, we get retractable, meaning that we are able to draw back or in something. So, a retractable leash is one that we can pull back in. Usually it pulls back into some kind of device. A non-retractable leash is one that we cannot pull back into a device. It is a fixed length.
You know, I always used to walk my dog with a retractable leash.
Really? Did you ever have any problems walking the dog?
No, but my dog was only about 8 kilograms.
Far smaller than the dogs in our report.
That's right. Well, thanks again for coming on the show today, John.
You're welcome. See you next time.
On tomorrow's education report, many American colleges have fewer students than they had before the COVID-19 pandemic. The National Student Clearinghouse Research Center says students have begun to return to two-year community colleges. But student numbers at four-year colleges remain lower than expected. With less money coming in and with higher costs, many schools are turning to budget cuts. Jill Robbins and Mario Ritter Jr. tell us more about this situation and its effects. Listen for that story tomorrow, or visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In Washington, D.C., you can get to many places by using the bus or metro train. And a lot of people use bicycles or scooters to get from one place to another. But it can still be useful to have a car.
And that's why Anna wants to get her driver's license. The license gives her legal permission to drive a car. To get the license, she has to take her driving test on a Saturday.
In Lesson 21 of the Let's Learn English series, Anna's friend Marcia invites her to a party. The party is on Saturday, so Anna thinks she can't go to it because of her driving test. Let's listen.
Hey, Anna. My friend is having a party on Saturday. Can you come with me?
Sorry, I can't come with you. I have to get my driver's license.
Will you be busy all day?
I don't know. First, I have to take a test on the computer. Then I have to take a test in the car.
But you have to take the test during the day, don't you?
Yes.
Luckily, Anna learns that the party is at night.
The party is at night.
Oh, then I can come with you to the party on Saturday night.
Great! I have to help my friend with the party. Can you help me?
Sure, that sounds like fun.
In a previous lesson of the day, Andrew and I explained how speakers of English change the pronunciation of the verb can when they talk more quickly. Can changes to kun. Listen again to Anna and Marcia. In these sentences, they mostly pronounce the verb can with slower speech.
The party is at night.
Oh, then I can come with you to the party on Saturday night.
Great! I have to help my friend with the party. Can you help me?
Sure, that sounds like fun.
Everyone has to bring something or do something. You can bring food or you can perform.
Really? I can perform?
You can. Can you?
Yes, I can recite poetry.
Did you notice that the more Anna wanted to emphasize or make her meaning clear, the slower she said the word can?
Oh, then I can come with you to the party on Saturday night.
Speaking a little faster, the pronunciation starts to change.
Really? I can perform?
And a little later, Marcia says,
Anna, maybe you can just bring food.
And if Jill quickly tells me that she can help me tomorrow, it sounds like this.
I can do it tomorrow.
Now, we're going to show another example of how we change vowel sounds and reduce words. Reducing means we make words shorter and faster. This next example uses the two words have to.
When Anna and Marcia say those two words quickly, the sound changes. First, listen to the slower speech.
Sorry, I can't come with you. I have to get my driver's license.
Will you be busy all day?
I don't know. First, I have to take a test on the computer. Then I have to take a test in the car.
But you have to take the test during the day, don't you?
Now, listen to the faster speech. First, you'll hear Marcia, then Anna.
Now I have to go shopping for food.
I have to help Marcia shop.
Now, listen to Jill and me say have to in a short conversation. So, Jill, what are you doing later this afternoon?
I have to look at the comments on our YouTube channel. How about you?
Well, I have to do a lot of things. I have to check my camera. I have to review some notes for a story. I have to go to the grocery store. I have to... what else do I have to do? Oh, I have to clean up some things, and I have to get ready for tomorrow.
Whoa, do you really have to do all that? Can't you wait and do some of it tomorrow?
I guess I don't have to get it all done, but I'd rather do it sooner.
I'd rather means that you prefer to do something or be something.
So, Jill, would you rather be a hammer or a nail?
Well, I don't think I would want to be either, but if I had to choose, I would be a hammer. But I'd rather be a bird than a hammer.
Me too. We're going to talk more about the phrase, I'd rather, in another lesson of the day.
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Now, let's go back to Lesson 21. Listen to these two sentences and see if you can identify or name the subject and verb of each sentence.
Everyone has to bring something or do something. Nobody recites poetry at parties.
Did you hear the subject and verb? In the first example, they were the words everyone has. And in the second one, they were the words nobody recites. Recites means to say something aloud, usually from memory, like a poem, speech, or the words to a song.
There is something interesting about the subjects of those sentences. In fact, the words are so special that everyone studies them in English class. Andrew, when you think of everyone, do you think of one or more than one person?
Well, of course, I think of more than one.
Yeah. You're thinking of lots of people. But here is why the word everyone is special. Listen to the example again.
Everyone has to bring something or do something.
Marcia says everyone has. Everyone means more than one person, but the verb has agrees with a singular subject. So that's how the word is special. The word nobody follows the same rule. We can think about more than one person when we say nobody, but the verb agrees with a singular subject. Listen.
Nobody recites poetry at parties.
Here are some more words that can refer to more than one person or thing, but that take a verb that agrees with a singular subject. The words are every, everyone, nobody, somebody, someone, everybody, anybody, and anyone.
In English-speaking countries, everybody learns the grammar rule for those words in school.
But not everyone remembers them.
And some people may not feel it sounds natural to follow that rule with the word every.
Here is a sentence you can use to help you remember the rule. Every window needs washing.
And here's some words from a song. Everybody loves somebody sometime.
Ah, yes, I know that song. Are you going to sing that, Jill?
Yeah. Everybody loves somebody sometime.
Sounds good to me.
Thanks. But there's a famous recording of that song by Dean Martin that sounds a lot better.
Well, Jill, what's the plan for our next lesson of the day?
I'm still working on that, but you just said something that gives me an idea. In Lesson 22 of Let's Learn English, Anna is planning her new show for children. Her producer, Amelia, asks her about it. Let's listen.
So, Anna, what's the plan for the show?
When we say, what's the plan for, that's just another way of saying, what will happen, or what are we going to do?
And we say, what's the plan for, when we are doing something together with another person or persons.
Tune in for our next podcast when we listen in on Anna making plans with her producer, Amelia. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.